Hello and welcome. My name is Sanjay Soni. Here is a microlearning readiness video on Azure Cosmos DB, Graph API, design considerations, and best practices. Thank you for taking the time to join us. Now, let's get started. Hi, Jay. How are you doing today?
I'm doing great. How are you doing, Sanjay?
I'm great as well, and thank you for being here with us.
Yeah.
So what do you do at Microsoft?
I'm an engineer in Azure Cosmos DB.
All right. So what are we going to talk about today?
Yes. So today we'll be talking about design considerations and best practices when you are building application using Azure Cosmos DB's Gremlin API. So today I'll start with recapping some of the core concepts about Gremlin API, and then we'll use that information to discuss some of the design patterns and the best practices.
All right. Let's get started.
Sure. So talking about core concepts, what is Gremlin API really? And to understand that, let's say relational databases have SQL API to ingest and query data. Similarly, Azure Cosmos DB's Gremlin or Graph API has a query language called Gremlin to ingest and query data.
Okay.
Now, some of the key differences between these two models is how you visually think about the data model, as well as when you are composing queries, how you reason about writing those queries.
All right. So can you please start with an example?
Sure. We have an example right here in these slides. And let's say the application that we're trying to build here is a social applications where user can follow one another. Now, the same application could be modeled using a relational model as well as a graph model. In the relational world, this can be done using two tables. One is user table and a follow table. Mm-hmm. The user table contains information about the users, and the follow table contains the mapping of who follows whom.
Okay.
Now, in the graph model, the same data could be modeled as vertices and edges, where vertices represents the user, and the edges coming from one vertex to another represents that one user follow another. Now, given this data model, let's assume that our query is to given a user, we want to find out who are all the users that are being followed by this user.
Okay.
And let's just assume that the entire workload consists of only this single query. Mm-hmm. Now, given this query, in the relational world, the same query could be executed by joining these two tables, where we are joining the user table and the follow table, and we put a filtering condition on the user table to identify user A. Now, one important thing to note here is that in the relational case, there is no way of directly addressing the row corresponding to the user, because in a relational world, tables are the first-class citizen.
Yes.
So we'll have to always go via the indirection of the tables. And with some filtering condition, you can identify user A. But unlike this, in a graph model, vertices are the first class citizen. And the way you execute the query is you identify the vertex within the graph, and then you start walking the graph in order to execute the query. And as you can see in this example, in this case, you can go to the graph, identify user A, walk along the edges to find out the outgoing vertices. Now, this notion of walking the graph as a part of executing the query is very important in case of a graph model, because not only it's the basis of the Gremlin query, it also tells you what would the cost and the latency of the query would be depending on how much of the graph that you're walking during the query execution.
All right. So can you please compare the cost of executing these queries on relational versus the graph model?
Yeah, that is actually a very interesting question. There is no direct way of answering this question, because depending on the query that you're executing, the cost, one model could win over the other model. Yeah. But the way I like to answer this question is what happens at scale, right? Let's say you have millions of users and millions of follow relationship.
Right.
And in that case, if you're trying to execute this query, what you'll do, you will end up joining these two huge tables. And this could lead to a lot of cost in the relational model just because the size of these two tables. On the other hand, in the graph model, even if the graph is very huge, what you are effectively doing is very quickly identifying the user vertex A, and then starting from there, you are just walking the graph. So even if the graph is huge, you're only traversing a very small portion of the graph.
Specific path.
Yes, exactly. And that's where graph model can benefit you a lot in terms of the cost.
All right. So can you please show us an example of how this Gremlin query would look like in this case?
Sure. So in this case, given the previous task, what we had is a toy graph. And here we are interested in finding out what are the users that are followed by user A. And in this case, the Gremlin query could simply look like g.v of A dot out dot in v. I'll explain that in a bit. Here, G refers to the entire graph. Okay. It's basically a reference to the graph. And then V of A, it's to identify the vertex A within the graph.
Okay.
And then the out step basically tells you what are all the outgoing edges coming from the previous step, that is from vertex A. And then in V indicates all the vertices that are at the end of all these outgoing edges. So in this case, it simply says C and D are the users that are being followed by A.
Okay.
Now, given this Gremlin query, we could map it to a general anatomy of a Gremlin query. And as you can see that on the right side of the slide here. And interesting to note here is the general anatomy of the Gremlin query, it's basically literally listing down the set of steps that you'll take during the walk on the graph.
Okay.
Now, there are a couple of formal way of explaining this. One is data flow language. So what that means is when you're executing this query, data is flowing from one step to another. And on the way, it's being transformed by the semantics of the operator. Another way of looking at this is from the function composition domain. That is, what you have here is a chain of functions which are executed in sequence. Now, apart from these two formal definitions, there is also a colloquial explanation to this. That is, you could think this Gremlin query as a series of tiny MapReduce steps, where each step takes a set of inputs, and depending on the semantics of the steps, it produces a set of output. And then it passes on that set of outputs as the input to the next step.
Okay, so it's like Hadoop world, MapReduce.
Yes, but, okay. But in a graph world, of course.
Interesting.
Now, actually, now take an example to understand this MapReduce style operation that happens on graph, even though at a very small scale. So here we have a very similar graph, and our query is g.v.out of out. That is, given the graph, we want to find out all the vertex that are there, and from all those vertices, we want to take two steps on the graph to find out who are all the vertices that are two steps away from that those vertex. And for the ease of analysis, I have a table here that shows you for each step, what are the input and what are the output that it's producing.
Okay, can you please explain the first row then?
Yes, of course. So the first step is V, which has an input G, that is the reference to the entire graph. And V step basically lists down all the vertices that are there in the graph. So okay. As you can see, the output is V1 to V5.
All five right? Nodes.
Exactly.
Nodes?
Yes. Yeah, node is right.
Okay.
And then the next step is out. Now note that the output of the previous step now becomes the input of the next step, that is V1 to V5. Now out step tells you, give me all the out vertices that are coming from this vertex.
Okay.
So in this case, V1 outputs V3 and V4. V2 outputs V4 again. V3, there is no output. And V4, there is V5.
Has no output.
V4 has V5.
Yeah.
And V5 has no output.
Yes.
So, and that consists all the output for this step, that is V3, V4 twice, and V5.
Great.
And now this becomes the input to the next out step. And as you can see here, V3 produces nothing. V4 produces V5. V4 produces V5 again. And then V5 doesn't produce anything. Now, one important thing to note here is that we have two instances of the V5 at the end of execution of this query. And that is because you can land up on multiple vertices depending on what path you took during the walk on the graph.
I see. So V.out.out lands in V5, V5.
Yes.
Okay. Fascinating.
Yeah. And for a small toy graph-like example, this is easy to understand and visualize. But Cosmos DB allows you to get this information programmatically. And that's what we see in the next slide here. Again, we have the same query on the left side. And on the right side, we show you the execution profile of the query. And you can easily get this by appending your Gremlin query by dot execution profile at the end. And I have color-coded this for the ease of understanding. So here, the step V produces this step, which tells you that at the end of executing this step, you had a result count of 5. That means it outputted 5 vertices. And if you can go through this list, what it will tell you that during the execution of the query or during this walk on the graph, you touched 11 vertices and 6 edges. And we define this as the footprint of the query. It's literally during the walk, what are the vertices and edges that you have touched.
I see.
And another thing that I want to reiterate here is This notion of the footprint is very important when you are analyzing the cost of the query, because the more the footprint of a query is, that means your query latency would be higher because of the very reason that you have to traverse those vertices and edges. And not only that, it's also associated with the cost of running the query, because for the very simple reason, the more the number of vertices and edges you fetch from the store, your cost would be higher as well. And because of this, your goal of doing a graph POC or building an application boils down to the fact that you want to write efficient queries so that this footprint is reduced as much as possible.
All right, so do you have an example of how one can reduce the footprint of their query?
Sure, Sanjay. I actually have many examples. I will start with this one. So on the left-hand side, we have a graph of a small company with their reporting chain. And the goal here is to, given the vertex with label V1, I want to find out who are all the vertices with label engineers that are two hop away from this vertex. And a very simple way of writing this Gremlin query is g.v has ID V1. This is to identify the vertex with label V1. And then we apply two out step to find out who are all of the vertices that are two step away. Mm-hmm. And then we apply a filtering condition to find out all the vertices with label engineer. And in this case, the answer would be vertex V6 and V7.
I see. And has is just like a where clause, pretty much.
Yes, exactly. And if you do the footprint analysis as before, you would find out that it actually touches 8 vertices and 7 edges. And it's easy to see here because you start with this vertex and then you touch this 2, and then all these 5 vertices, that means 8 vertex, and along the way we touch all the 7 edges.
I see.
Now, given this query, you can apply some domain knowledge and apply some of those filters early to actually reduce the footprint. And the domain knowledge in this case we can use is the fact that only engineers can report to managers and not HR managers.
Right.
And we can use this fact to apply a filter early. And what we're trying to do here is, as you can see, after the first out step, I will only traverse further if I know that the label of the current vertex is a manager and not an HR manager. In that way, I can prune out the part of the graph that's at the bottom of this graph.
I see. So it's more efficient because you're completely ignoring that path, if you would. You're going to this other path.
Exactly. Okay. And I could do that because I have this domain knowledge. And if you do the footprint analysis, you would see that now the query has footprint of 6 vertices and 5 edges. Now, let's look at another example. So in this case, we have exactly the same graph as before, mm-hmm. And we want to find out the same query as before, that is given vertex V1, which are all the engineers that are two hop away. If we write the exact same query, we have 8 vertices and 7 edges, but in this case, we could optimize the query even further by labeling some of the edges. So if you go back to the previous slide, we had a very generic label of reported by. It tells you this person on the left-hand side is reported by the person on the right-hand side. But what you can do is we can label them a little bit differently by knowing the relationship between these two vertex. So in this case, I am labeling this vertex as RB_manager. This tells me if I go down this edge or if I traverse this edge, at the end of this, I will find somebody with label manager. In this case, if I traverse down this vertex, I know that I'll end up with somebody which has a label HR manager. And using that information, I can actually now prune more portion of the graph.
Okay.
So now our query can become is g.v has ID V1, that is to identify vertex V1, and this time I know that to be able to find an engineer, there is no point traversing the edge with HR manager. I will only need to traverse edges that is label manager.
Okay.
And by that way, I can directly go to this guy. And then from that point onwards, I can only traverse edges labeled as engineer so that I don't have to traverse all the edges that's labeled as intern. In this way, I can prune down the graph traversal even more. And as you can see, the footprint has been reduced to 4 vertices and 3 edges from 8 vertices and 7 edges.
Fantastic.
Building off the last example, we have another simple example here. Here, you can apply the trick of not visiting the same vertex multiple times. So here we have, again, a simple example where given vertex V1, we want to find out who are all the vertices that are his reporting chain, irrespective of whether they are one hop away or two hop away. And the simple way to do this query is by doing an union. So you say g.v of has ID V1, and then union of outstep, comma, out.out. This will give you all the vertices that are one hop as well as two hop away. Now, one interesting thing to note here is that if you run this union query, you will execute this outstep twice, because it's part of both the clause in the union. Right. And what you can do here is you can execute the first outstep once, store the results using a step called asstep, and then use it to compute both the outstep. And as you can see, you can go through this example and find out that the footprint of this query would be 8 vertices and 7 edges instead of 10 and 9. And let's look at another example. And this example is about explicit versus implicit age modeling. Again, we have a very simple toy graph on the left-hand side. And the query is we want to find out all the reports of vertex V1. And as before, the simple query is g.v of v1.out to find out all the reports. But one interesting thing to note here is that if all the vertex has their manager information embedded within the vertex itself, then you don't have to traverse this graph to find them. You could do a simple query like g.v has manager v1. In this way, you can look through your graph and find out all the vertices that has label manager v1 without traversing all these edges as well as this vertex. So in this case, your query footprint become 3 vertices from 4 vertex and 3 edges.
Great. So you talked about a useful list of patterns, but I'm assuming that this is not an exhaustive list of patterns. What are some of those other patterns?
Yeah, that's a good question. You are right that this is not really an exhaustive list of patterns, and it's not possible to sort of enumerate all those patterns here, right? But the main takeaway of this session is all the things that you have discussed in this, for example, execution profile and how we can compute the footprint from the execution profile, could be used to find out what different optimization that you can make. And your clue here would be to look for cases where the footprint is very high. And if you use that information to go back and see if you can change your data model or apply some domain knowledge to make sure that you are traversing less vertices and less edges in order to optimize your queries further.
All right, this is great information. So where can customers go to find more information about all this?
Sure. You can always go to our official documentation page of Azure Cosmos DB, and you can also send us an email as listed in the slide here.
Great. Thank you so much, Jay, for being here with us today.
It was my pleasure.
Thank you for watching this microlearning readiness video about Azure Cosmos DB. To learn more about this and other topics, please go to azure.com/CosmosDB. Please stay tuned for more videos.